Good morning. How's everyone doing? You doing good? That's good stuff about the voting. I'll tell you this, I really believe, you know, one of the candidates, I won't say who, but one of the candidates is saying that he will repeal the Johnson Amendment. Well, I kind of just told it, didn't I? Anyway, but I tell you, I don't know. I'm not good with that stuff. But anyways, they say they repeal the Johnson Amendment. And that, does anyone know what the Johnson Amendment is? Does anyone know what it is? It's an amendment that you cannot talk about political candidates. How many know, until about 60 years ago, pastors could say anything from the pulpit. They had the First Amendment right. And it was funny, this how they found out about it, is one of the candidates said, the person I wasn't supposed to say, but one of the candidates said, well, you need to tell your people to vote for me because I'm going to repeal this thing. He didn't say that. He said, tell your people that I'm for you guys. And he said, well, we can't tell. They said, we can't tell people because we're bound by the Johnson Amendment. And this candidate said they'll repeal it. So how do we know? That's exciting news. Amen? Now, some of you said, you know, Craig, you know, don't be so political, but hear this. It was the pastors, they were called the Black Robe Regiment. It was the pastors who were the ones that helped fuel the breaking away from England. They were the ones who said, hey, this is not right what they're doing. The king is not God. He's put in position by God, but he's not God. Remember what it said? Speak out against the king, speak out against God. And so the people started saying, this is not biblical. And it was pastors who did that. And how many know we need pastors like that again? Amen. We need pastors to be free. Amen. Yeah, clap. To speak and to say what the Bible says, but we're so afraid. I can tell it. Whenever I talk about issues, you guys, you know, I mean, I talk about homosexuality. And yet I know you feel what the Bible says, most of you do, but you've been trained like Pavlov's dog whenever you talk about to get scared. But how many know we're supposed to speak the truth in love? Amen. And we need to pray that. I can't imagine. It's been 60 years. It was snuck through by Johnson, our president. What was his name? What was his first initials? Lyndon Johnson. That's right. Lyndon. It was snuck through a midnight session of Congress, and it's been on the books. And I don't know why it's been on the books this long, especially when we take great pride as a country of having free First Amendment rights, right? Everyone else is saying whatever they want to say, right? But why can't pastors speak the truth? And why can't I? Now, I'm not about saying vote for this candidate, vote for that, but wouldn't it be neat if you could tell what both candidates say and have no fear? Wouldn't it be neat to say this candidate represents this candidate, and now you have that threat and that fear of taking away your tax-exempt status? And I just don't think that's right, amen? We should be free to say what we believe is true, and all of us should be able to say that, right? We should be able to have true tolerance. What does tolerance mean? It means if you say something I don't agree with, I tolerate you because I respect you as a human being. Amen? That's tolerance. Not me forcing you to believe what I believe. Tolerance. We need it again. Anyways, if you have a Bible, enough of that. I can see you guys say, okay, enough of the politics. All right, we'll move on. We're going to now be in the book. I'm very excited about this. 1 Corinthians. How many excited about that? Amen? I'm a New Testament guy. I love the Old Testament. Don't get me wrong, but I just don't know why I get so excited about the New Testament. I like the New Covenant. Amen. It's a better covenant. I love the Old Testament. Don't get me wrong, but the New Covenant really gets me excited. So let me read this real quick. I guess I'm not done with the voting thing. Dietrich Bonhoeffer said this. Does everyone know who Dietrich Bonhoeffer is? He was the Lutheran German pastor who stood up to the Nazis during World War II. And how many know that was a big, he hung for that? How many know when you're willing to put your life on the line to die for what is right and for Christ, that's a man of God. And he did that. And here's what he said. This is what Bonhoeffer, because here this, Bonhoeffer snuck away to New York to escape the persecution. But then he realized, what am I doing? I need to go back to my countrymen and help them, and I need to speak the truth and try to change this evil. And here's what he said. Silence in the face of evil is evil itself. God will not hold us guiltless. Not to speak is to speak. Not to act is to act. Not to vote is to vote. Now, just put that in there. But anyway, but you know what I mean? We cannot, I hear so many of us complain about how things are, but how many know, until you vote, you have no right to complain of where our country's going. Amen? So vote. Vote your biblical values. I can say that. Don't get afraid. Vote what is the best, the least of the worst. Amen? Vote the best biblical candidate. Amen? Enough of that. I promise. That's it. All right. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 1. And as I was studying for the book of Corinthians, I want to just tell you guys, I am so glad that I am not the pastor of Corinth. Amen? That church, if you know anything about this book, I tell you, that church, whew, I mean, it's like, it makes our church look like we are super spiritual. Amen? I mean, this church, the only thing they had, maybe honest, is the gifts. They flowed in the gifts, but boy, that church was something. If churches were graded, and how many know Jesus did grade the seven churches of Revelation? He did grade them, and he says, I like this, but I don't like this. I have this against you. And if we were to grade the church of Corinth, they would probably have to be very nice, probably be given a D minus. It would be given a D. I mean, maybe not an F, but a D. For being divided, for being defiled, and for being defamed. Defaming the name of Jesus. Bringing a reproach to the name of Jesus. Remember a man in 1 Corinthians 5, a man was sleeping with his father's wife. Now people say, oh, that was his stepmom. You know, the New Living tries to make it nice. But how many know it says even the pagans wouldn't do this? How many know that was probably his own mom? That's how debauched, that's how messed up the Corinth church was. I love what one of the commentators said. He says, the city of Corinth was affecting the church more than the church was affecting the city of Corinth. How many believe that's true for our country today? The country and the world is telling the church what to say, and the world's conforming to the world rather than trying to conform the world to Christ. And I pray that we want to be a church that helps conform the world back to Jesus. Amen? A reformation. You know what reformation means? Reshape. Reform. How many know? A lot of us try to reform our bodies. Reshape it. How many know we need to reshape our country? We need to bring it back to the Lord. This letter written by Paul addressing these problems would have to, if I had to grade it, I would give it an A+. Amen? This is in a phenomenal book. This talks more about any church in the Old Testament and the New Testament. More about It talks more about the Church of Corinth than all the real issues of being a healthy church than any other book in the Bible, many scholars say. This is Paul's first letter to the Corinthian church. And you can divide it into basically two parts. The first part is chapters 1 through 6. It deals with the concerns Paul had about them. And now hear this. He starts this off because they wrote him a letter concerning marriage. They said, hey, we have this question about marriage. But Paul here, being a pastor, having a pastor's heart, he says, hey, let me address six chapters about what you need to fix. How many know that's pretty wild? You can tell right there. He doesn't even get to the answer to the question. First six chapters is telling them what is not right with the church, the concerns he has about them as a church. Chapters 7 through 16, that's the end of the book, deal with the answers that Paul has for them. In these concerns, Paul answers and instructs the Corinthian church, every other church, and for every other church in the future regarding effective ministry, true unity, here's what he's going to teach on, Christian charity or love, spiritual maturity, the meaning of liberty. He instructs them regarding church conduct, spiritual gifts, how to use them right, and the resurrection of the dead. He wrote to them regarding the problem of division. And how many know division is a big thing in the church today? You see, it says in Proverbs, I believe 6, he says that God hates those who spread strife amongst the brethren. How many know there's a lot of strife in churches? There's a lot of strife between churches. And how many know God, as we'll see today, hates that? God doesn't want that. God wants it to be a unified body of Christ, not just this body, but also the other believing churches to be unified, even though we agree on the essentials, but hopefully agree to disagree on the non-essentials. Amen? You awake? Amen. But you should have that. And the definition, although this book is best known for the 13th chapter of 1 Corinthians, which is the love chapter. Remember, love is kind, love is patient, love does not seek its own, right? The whole letter of Paul to the Corinthians overall is an awesome letter. One I believe we'll find to be exceedingly practical and incredibly helpful to us as Christians today. So let's pray and ask God to just bless this time. Is anyone hot in here or is it just me? A little toasty, Kevin? We're a little toasty. We're going to go to sleep. I see everyone here is like chill them out. Just freeze them, Kev. No, I'm just teasing. I'm kidding. Father, thank you so much for this day, and thank you for the sweet time of worship. Thank you for Cheryl sharing with us. And just, Father, I pray that we'll want to be that salt and light, Lord, that we want to be a preservative, and we want to be the one who shines light in the dark areas of this world and our friends and family members and coworkers, that we don't want to just sit back passively. Lord, what a sad thing if we heard you say, "Depart from me, you wicked, lazy servant." As we sang today, we want to hear you say, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." Amen. So God, give us that boldness, Lord. Let us not be obnoxious. But I believe that most of us here don't struggle. Maybe a few of us, but very few of us struggle with being obnoxious. Most of us struggle with timidity and fear and being pushed into the closet, being pushed into the closet of political correctness. But Lord, I ask that you'll make us biblically correct, that we would say, "God, I want to honor you. I want to speak when you want me to speak. I want to pray when you want me to pray. I want to vote the way you want me to vote." So God, lead us, direct us. Let us be a people who change the culture around us, that we allow you in us to shine light and dispel and chase out the darkness. Let us have that hope, Lord. That's why we're here. We wouldn't be here if we couldn't have an effect. So God, and when that day comes where we have no effect, you're going to rapture us out of here. But Lord, until that day comes, let us have effectiveness. Let us have influence. Let us have favor without compromise. Bless your people, Lord. And as we study this word today, open our hearts and open our minds to the word. You said a natural man, as you'll say in this book, does not discern or understand the things of the Spirit. Let us be men of the Spirit and women of the Spirit who get what your word is saying to us. And that it changes. It doesn't just give us more information, but it literally transforms the way we think, the way we act, and ultimately the way we live. Bless your people, Lord. Thank you for them. Thank you for their hunger for the word, and give them even a greater hunger for your word. And then, Lord, move them into a desire to be effectual doers of what they learn from your word. Bless them and their families and their witness. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. And everyone agreed, said,
amen.
Amen. Verse 1 of 1 Corinthians 1. Paul called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ through the will of God. The word "to be" here is in italics. And as usually the case, when the translators added them to clarify the sentence, they actually clouded it. And let me explain that to you. We believe here at Calvary that the word of God is inerrant. Amen? It's infallible. Amen? Does everyone agree with that? The word is God-breathed. All scripture is God-breathed. Not just the ones we like and don't like. All scripture is God-breathed, it says in 2 Timothy. So hear this, but as they translate it from the Greek or from the Hebrew, how many know things don't translate always so easily? And so the translators kind of add some words. And hear this, they don't change the context. Let me give you an example of this. The Dead Sea Scrolls. Everyone heard about the Dead Sea Scrolls found, you know, whatever, how many years ago, quite a few years ago. But they found the book of Isaiah. And in the book of Isaiah you have in your Bible and the book of Isaiah they found in the Dead Sea Scrolls, there's only about 6 or 7 discrepancies. That's pretty good for 58 chapters. I think it's 58 chapters, 60, I don't know. It's 58? 60 what? 66. Thank you, David. Scholar. But 66 chapters and there's only 7 discrepancies possibly, but they don't change they're not enough to change the context, to change the understanding of it. So how many of that's pretty good? If you ever play the telephone game, you just say a little thing like, "Hey, some little message," and it's changed after about 10 people. So that's pretty amazing. But hear this, to be here is so they'll add these little words to help kind of make it more readable. That's why the most accurate translation is the hardest reading translation to read, and that's the New American Standard. Most scholars will say the New American Standard is the most accurate, but it's a very hard read because it's so, it's not real smooth. But here it is in the King James, it's more poetic. They add "to be an apostle." But here's the problem. The verse should actually read, "Paul called an apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ," of Jesus Christ. Apostleship was not something that an office he was trying to achieve or attain, but rather a definition of who he was, one who was sent out by Jesus. Amen? So, you know, you don't say, I'm going to be an apostle. I guess technically I could be an apostle because I started this church. right? So sent out. I was sent out by other Calvaries, and I was sent out. So apostle. But here that, apostle here, though, means he saw Jesus, right? The apostles, the 12, and he's like the 13th, but they actually saw Jesus' ministry. So did Paul. He saw Jesus, met with him, he says. So he is an apostle by Jesus Christ. He didn't earn it. And then it says, end of verse 1, and Sosthenes, I have a hard time with that name, Sosthenes, our brother. Paul wrote this letter to a man named Sosthenes, he wrote it with a man named Sosthenes beside him. Perhaps the name might ring a bell to somebody. Has anyone heard that name, Sosthenes? No? Okay, well, I'll tell you about it then. In Acts 8:6, when Paul was in Corinth the first time, he preached the gospel in the synagogues. But when he proclaimed that Jesus was the Messiah, the Jews got so angry, they protested so vehemently that Paul had to shake the dust off his clothes. And he had to finally say to them, your blood be upon your own heads. I'm now going to the Gentiles. Isn't that amazing? That God, hear this, if God's calling you today to come to him, if you're not giving your life to him, realize there can come a day when God will finally say enough. How many know that's blasphemy of the Holy Spirit? It's when the Holy Spirit's been drawing you, convicting you, drawing you, and you keep saying no, 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 and finally God says, okay. And that's what was happening here. Paul finally said, okay, you don't want to hear it anymore? I will now go to the Gentiles. And he moved from them to speaking to the Jews, to the Gentiles. When he got to the Gentiles, where did Paul go? He went right next door to the house of Justice, also called Gaius. And when he started teaching there, many were converted, including Crispus. Hear this, the leader of the synagogue. How many know that'll touch some people? Hey, our leader, if all of a sudden I converted to some other religion, that would touch you. Whoa, what's going on here? And so all of a sudden, the synagogue leader of all these people that are angry gets converted to Christ. As a result, the Jews were provoked to godly jealousy, as Paul spoke of in Romans 11:14. How many know there can be a godly jealousy? We should pray that. We should pray that you and I live such godly lives that our friends and family members see it. They see your marriage. They see your children. And they go, man, I want that. I'll tell you, one of the greatest compliments I ever had was we just came down from Mount Lemmon, and we were a ski thing. And I think I may have told you this. I don't know if I said it already, but I had, sorry. But this other Christian that had fallen away, their family saw us playing in the parking lot. We still had the snow on our car, and we were playing like snowball fights. And they said they saw us, and they go, man, I want to be a Christian family like that. How many know that should be all of us? Amen? That should be all of us, to where our families, people get, they have a godly jealousy. They go, man, where, I don't have that joy like they have. I don't have that love in with my spouse like they have. We should have that. Amen? We should provoke people to godly jealousy, a jealousy for God, not jealousy like for each other, but jealousy for God. When Galileo, a new deputy, was assigned to the region of Corinth, the Jews wasted no time in presenting their accusations against Paul. Led by a man named Sosthenes. You just remember that name? So here Paul is with Sosthenes, but now this man is leading. So here's a man, and many scholars believe it's the same one. The same person, Sosthenes. He stormed into Galileo's office and saying, the man next door to our synagogue is teaching things contrary to the Jewish law. Yet even before Paul could open his mouth, in his own defense, Galileo said, I don't have time to settle religious disputes. And he drove them out of his office. And angry, so angry the Jews with the one who had pleaded their case, the Jews, his own countrymen, beat him up. They beat up Sosthenes. And that's found in Acts 18:17, if you want to look at it. But how many know that's pretty bad when you're representing the Jews and you're mad at Paul, and all of a sudden they say you didn't do a good enough job and they start pounding? How many know that's rough? And so Sosthenes is kind of frustrated. Evidently, it was at this point that something happened to him. For shortly after, Sosthenes became a Christian, and that's why I love this. I just heard a saying the other day that I really like. It says, a broken heart is an open heart. Amen? And I'll tell you this, you know, I'm not saying, you know, if you struggle with depression that you shouldn't take pain or depression medication, but hear this. I think sometimes they say the number one medication, the number one drug in America is pain medication. And how many know that sometimes it's the very pain that we try to avoid that brings people to Christ? Amen? And sometimes we need to be careful. You know, my cousin, my Italian cousin, who's just like a thug, and he goes, they gave me so much Prozac that you could just throw a gallon of gas on me, light me on fire, I wouldn't even care. How many of that's not good? Okay? But sometimes they over-medicate. But guess what? Sometimes it's the pain. And this is good for us parents to know too. When our kids go through hard stuff, sometimes we need to let them go through it so that they can realize their need for Jesus. And man, if we always enable or rescue them, they're never going to realize, wait a sec, I need Jesus. I remind you of this story of Sosthenes for a reason, and that is that although Sosthenes, who led the protests against Paul in our text, we see Sosthenes now laboring with Paul, writing letters with him, helping be his scribe. The same is still true. People who are most violently opposed to you and your faith are often the very ones who are most convicted by the Holy Spirit in you. The very ones who are closest to conversion. Just let them take a few more beatings from their friends and from this world. And like Sosthenes, they will come around. Amen? Amen. How many of this world will beat you up? I'll tell you, you know, I can't tell you how many times I'd be drinking. My friends would say, oh, die with you, Rotors. I love you, man. And then I remember being in a fight, and I got a fight with the other football team, and all my friends and all my football players. I'm saying, let's do it. I'm leading the pack. And I look back, and there's only two of them. There was 30, 20, and now there's only two of them. And I mean, I said, when I'm done with these guys, I'm coming after you. Because how many, you know what I mean? Oh, we'll die with you, Rotors. We'll be, how many know? You get that happen to you enough times, you realize the world ain't so great. Amen? That was a weak amen, but I'll take it. When I share the gospel with people, the response I least like to hear is this. I'm so glad that works for you. How many have heard that? That's so good. That's so good for you. You need that. How many have heard that, right? I'll never forget, I was witnessing on the plane with Robert Furrow, the other Calvary pastor, and we're on the plane. He was just watching me, and there's this young black girl, and she was on the plane, so I asked her, hey, where are you from? She goes, I'm from Stanford. I go, oh, what are you doing? I'm at Stanford Law, and I'm like, oh, neat. No, she's being a doctor. She goes, I'm going to be a doctor, and so I'm just telling her my testimony, and after I tell her my testimony, she just goes, that is so neat for you. Look at you. That's just precious. Good for you. And I'm like, do you ever think about heaven or hell or where you're going to go when you die? Nope. Do you ever think about anything? Nope. You know, I mean, I'm just like, you know, and Robert, I'm like looking for Robert to help me. He's like, hey, you're on your own, baby. You know, I mean, and I mean, she couldn't care less. I said, you ever think about death? You ever think about God? Nope. So what do you think about? Money. You know, that's about it. You know, it was like nothing. And I will tell you, that is the most frustrating thing of all. Because the opposite of love is not hate. The opposite of love is what? Apathy. Apathy, just don't care. That's good for you, whatever, dude. I don't care. On the other hand, when someone responds to the gospel in a very angry, hostile way, I know I've got a person who's truly wrestling with God. And he or she is being convicted probably by the Holy Spirit. That's why they get so angry. Amen? I used to do a live call-in radio show. Can you imagine me doing it? I did a live call-in radio show and for 2 hours, and they wanted to do 3 hours, but I said, no, two's good. But and we used to do it, and it was for youth, and it was just great. It was live here in town, and I never forget, I would get people all the time calling up, and they would say, Pastor Craig, or they'd say, Craig, I wasn't a pastor, I was doing the radio show, but they'd say, Craig, I believe I blasphemed the Holy Spirit. I think I've lost my salvation. And I go, you haven't blasphemed the Holy Spirit. And they go, how do you know? I haven't even told you what I did yet. I go, I know you haven't. And they go, how do you know? I said, because the fact that you're worried about blaspheming the Holy Spirit shows me you haven't blasphemed the Holy Spirit. Because if you truly blaspheme the Holy Spirit, right, if you really curse the Holy Spirit, as found in Mark 3:29, then guess what? You wouldn't care anymore because the Holy Spirit wouldn't be bothering you. It wouldn't be convicting you. Amen? If you're worried about your sin, that's a good place. The day you go, you know what, whatever. You know, Christians aren't perfect, just forgiven, who cares? Then you need to be concerned. But the fact that you are being convicted, you don't feel good about it, goes why? The Holy Spirit wants to lead you into all truth. So the Holy Spirit's job is to what? Convict the world of sin. It's not me supposed to do that. You know, sometimes people say, Craig, you're so convicted, you're so harsh. How many know? The Holy Spirit's convicting you. The Holy Spirit's trying to say, come on, wake up. And hear this. We want godly sorrow that leads us to what? Repentance. Worldly sorrow, if you don't want to repent, if you don't want to listen to God, then that'll turn into worldly sorrow, which what? Leads into death. Think about the difference. Peter wept, but he returned back to God. He denied God, but he returned back. Judas denied God and betrayed God, but what happened? He went and hung himself. He had sorrow. He felt bad. He threw back the money, but then he did what? He hung himself. How many want to be like Peter? I want to be convicted. I want to turn back and repent and say, God, I'm sorry. But I like it when people get a little frustrated. I like it. I one time did the same show. I did a live show in the gay bar. How many know I was a little hostile? I was ready. I was just amazed at how not hostile it was. I prayed and fasted. How many of you better be praying and fasting? You go into a gay bar and talk about what God says about homosexuality. But it was one of the best shows we ever did, wasn't it? I mean, it was amazing. And every one of them believed in God, and I almost thought they were duping me. It was amazing. One guy was an agnostic. And then I told him, remember the thing about agnostic? What does it mean to be agnostic? It means in Latin, ignoramus. So I said, you really want to call yourself an ignoramus? And then he goes, okay, well, I'm just not sure where I stand with God. I go, that's a lot better. Because how many know, a lot of people believe in God, they just don't want to deal with God. Amen? Verse 2. To the church of God, which is at Corinth. Paul doesn't say here, to the church of Corinth. He says, to the church of God, which is at Corinth. Big difference, amen? There's no church of Corinth. There's no church of England. There's no church of Calvary at Oro Valley. But there is what? There is one church. One church, the church of God. And I was just thinking about that. How many know we live in very interesting times? Because you can't, you know, we try to say, I've had people try to tell me, Mormons are Christians. How many know Mormons are not Christians? Amen? There's a lot of things we can disagree on, but you cannot disagree on the deity of Christ. And I said that to this Mormon. He was telling me all this other stuff. I just witnessed a Mormon a couple months ago. I said, hey, is man sinful? Oh, yeah, we're sinful. I said, okay. And Jesus was a man, right? God, man, but he was the Son of God, but he's still a man. I said, yes. So how can another man who's sinful die for us who are sinful? I said, that's the issue. Only God. Remember what Jesus said? Remember when the rich young ruler came to Jesus? He said, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And he said, why do you call me good? Only God is good. Do you hear what Jesus was saying? Are you getting that who I am, that I'm God? Jesus is not just the Son of God. He is God Almighty. And that's why Jesus, who is sinless, but yet is also 100% man, could die in our place. Amen? So if you don't believe in who Jesus is, that undoes your salvation. That doesn't cut it. You got to be, that's one essential that you got to hold on to. Amen? And I don't care what people say. I've had so many people argue that with me because they'll say they're such good people. Yeah. There's people that are better morally than I that are not going to go to heaven. Because that's not what saves you, is it? It's not being a good person that saves you. It's putting your faith in Christ that saves you. Now, you should be becoming a good person, but that's not what saves you. Amen? The church of God, located at Corinth, was an interesting place. Corinth, hear this, was a city in south central Greece that was prosperous economically due to its location geographically. You see, Corinth was only 4 miles from the Aegean Sea. So avoid sailing around the southern tip of Greece, where they said, if you went around the southern tip of Greece back in those days, they said, you better write out your will because you're probably not coming home. You better say goodbye to your family. That's how rough it was. So they would go through this channel, but the channel didn't go all the way through. And it would end right at Corinth, and then I'm getting ahead of myself. I'll tell you in a second what they did. But it was rough, treacherous. Sailors would sail through the channel to Corinth and unload their ships, hear this, then put them on rollers and roll them 4 miles to the Aegean Sea. Now, They've made that canal go all the way through now. Caesar Nero tried to do it. He failed. But then the guys who did the Suez Canal, they also made that channel go through. So now it goes through. But they used to roll. Can you imagine rolling the ships 4 miles? They'd roll these ships, empty them and roll them for 4 miles because it was so much better than going around because it was so treacherous. So it was a very prosperous port. A lot of people went there. But it was also a wicked city. It was just as wicked as it was prosperous. Every night, 1,000 temple prostitutes left the temple of Aphrodite, the false goddess of love, and went through the city recruiting business in the name of the worship of Aphrodite. Can you imagine how sinful that is? Can you imagine how I got to go worship? Got to get my groove on. I mean, can you imagine? But that's what it was. And you can tell. I always love what Ravi Zacharias says. You can always tell a man-made religion because it'll always oppress women and it always gives men what they want immorally, right? And you see that. I love how he says, you know how I know the Bible's true? Because no man would say, love your enemy. No man would say, pray for those who despitefully use you. No man would say, bless those who curse you. He says, that's how I know the word of God is the word of God. Because we would say, you know, no man would say that. They'd say, kill them, smite them, right? What does the Quran say? You know, kill the infidel. And you see that. And you guys, that's what it says, right? And then you know how I always say, well, the Quran says don't kill innocents. Do you know an innocent is someone, the innocent is only someone who's a Muslim. If you're not a Muslim, you're not innocent. So you can be killed. Amen? And you need to know that. That's how crazy it is. And we try to say, do you know, I just read this week that a school in Boston just slipped a paper through that was saying how to cleanse yourself for Ramadan to be a clean Muslim. Could you imagine if a paper came out of how to tithe or how to be a good Christian? And in that reporter you saw, the guy from Fox, he goes, a good thing it wasn't Christian because the whole world would have stopped. So because of that false worship, the coffers of the temple of Aphrodite were very full, as you can imagine. In addition, Corinth was a philosophical center along with Athens. Corinth was a favorite for philosophers. This made for an interesting mix in Corinth, a city engaged in lofty discourse by day and total depravity and wickedness by night. Thus, it's no surprise that when that it was from Corinth that Paul penned this letter. Now hear this. They used to say when they did Greek plays, when they would show a Corinthian, he was always drunk. And they would say, you're like a Corinthian. That meant you were drunk, you're a drunkard, and you're immoral. How many know that's pretty bad when your name is a Corinthian? If you're called a Corinthian, you were a drunk and immoral sexually. That's what it was. And they always showed him in plays, drunk. They were always. So it was very, everyone knew what Corinth. If you were a Corinthian, it wasn't a good thing. So here's Paul. He penned his letter to the Romans, where he then traced the devolution of men. Now, isn't this amazing? We think if you go to the U of A or a college like it, what will you hear? Man is what? Evolving. Amen? You'll hear that. Man's evolving. We're evolving. We're getting better every day. Now, we might be getting better technologically, but how many know? Do we have more communication than we've ever had today, don't we? But yet, we're the most disconnected relationally. We can tell everything on our Facebook, but we can't talk to our spouse face to face. We text each other, right? I could text my wife right now. How you doing, honey? Love you. But can't tell her I love her. I mean, that's weird. Okay? But we think we're evolving. But hear this. Hear this. In 1973, what happened? Does anyone know? Abortion was legalized. Do you know what the people said? The liberal agenda said? They said, if you allow abortion, then every child will be a wanted child. And the child abuse will basically cease. Doesn't that sound great? You go, oh yeah, that's so good. That seems to make sense. But we've had abortion now for 43 years. Killed over 50 million, what is it now, 55 million babies in America alone. In the world, China and India, oh my goodness, off the charts. But hear this, that little experiment of evolution, child abuse has gone up 400%. So why? Because we cheapen life. And so a dad or a mom says, wait a sec, if I could have killed you in the womb, why can't I kill you outside the womb? Amen? And you see that. You see that we are de-evolving. We are not evolving. We're going worse. Because why? We're getting worse because we're getting away from God. So here's what Paul says, and you see how this relates not just to Corinth, but to Romans, but to us. Romans 1, chapter 1, verse 25. And here's what he's writing as he's looking at all the sin at Corinth. He's writing this: they traded the truth about God for a lie. Sound like any country you know? They traded the truth of God for a lie. How many know? I pray you guys want, how many of you want the truth? Raise your hand. I hope you say, you know what, enough. I'm tired of the lie. I want the truth again. That's revival, amen? When you say enough is enough, I want the truth. And that's why I show you every scripture, because I want you to be a person who knows the truth and loves the truth. And so he says, they traded the truth about God for a lie. And here's what happens to those who trade the truth of God for a lie. See if you see any similarities with any country you know. So they worshiped and served the things God created, Mother Earth, worshiping creation, instead of the Creator himself, who is worthy of eternal praise. Amen. Verse 26, that is why God abandoned them. See, if you don't want God, if you say, I'm tired of you, God, I don't like you, God, I don't want your truth, God, how many know God will honor you after a while? He will say, okay. If America keeps saying, God, get out of here, leave us alone, how many know he will honor it? And that's why I pray for you, the remnant. The people that want truth will say, God, intercede and stand in the gap and say, God, have mercy on us. Please bring an awakening again to you and your word. Amen? And you have to cry out, and you have to vote, and you have to be engaged, because you're not here just to watch TV. You're here to make a difference. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Your Christ in you is to make a difference. But he says this, he abandoned them to their shameful desires. Even the women turned against the natural way to have sex and instead indulged in sex with each other. Verse 27, and men, instead of having normal relations with women, burned with lust for each other. Men did shameful things with other men, and as a result of this sin, they suffered within themselves the penalty they deserved. Do you know why our country is struggling so much with homosexuality and transgenderism and bathrooms? We don't know who should be in what bathroom. It's because we've traded the truth of God for a lie. And if you're not sure, people say, it's not that bad. Have another one. Because that's what God says. When you trade the truth of God for a lie, this is what happens. Extreme homosexuality. You see it being, and now it's not, hear this. It's not live and let live. It's now you will accept us. As Cheryl said, the church, how many know, they're trying to push it to where I'll have to marry two homosexual men or two homosexual women. Now, you know what? I believe that they have the right to do what they want to do. You know, I don't think it's right, but I believe, you know what I mean? I'm not going to force them to be Christians, amen? But how many know, they want to force me and you to say, they want, how many know, they're pushing for Christian schools to have transgender bathrooms. Yet they'll allow a Muslim who's working to have, what, four prayer breaks in the middle of his day. But they won't allow a Christian, where the Bible clearly says that that is a sin, they won't allow them to have their religious belief to say, I love you as a person, but I respectfully have to disagree that that is an alternative lifestyle in Christ. How many have a problem with that? Now hear this. Now hear me so you don't go, oh, we love the homosexual. We just don't love the sin of homosexuality. We love the sinner, but we hate the sin. But guess what's happening? The liberal agenda is trying to say you will accept this sin and you won't call it sin and you'll say it's cool. But how many know if you do that, then you are denying Christ and his word. Amen. And you better be afraid, because Jesus says if you add to this or take away from this, then all the curses, it says in Revelation, will be put on you. You need to say, if God says it, that settles it. I love what one pastor said. You know, they said, if God says it, I believe it, that settles it. I mean, I love what one pastor said. It doesn't matter if you believe it or not, it's still settled. So you can say, oh, I don't believe that. Well, it doesn't matter. It's in the word. You're someday going to believe it, because you're going to see you should have believed it. And so we might as well just believe what the Bible says. I can see you getting quiet on me. I'm going to get you guys bold. You know, give me time. You get around David, he'll make you bold. No, you know. Anyways, He sings real loud. Middle of verse 2. To those who are sanctified in Christ Jesus. The word sanctified here literally means to be what? Set apart. The Greek word has its roots in the idea of marriage, where one is set apart to someone and for someone. A husband to his wife, a wife to his husband. How many know this? In all our liberal thinking, how many know most people still think adultery is wrong, do they not? Most people go, ooh, that's not right. You can't do that. Unless it's an open marriage and you're all like, ooh, we're just real liberal. But most people would say that's bad still, right? And that's what it is. You now, we sang the song, we've been bought with the precious blood of Christ. You are bought. Your life, when you became a Christian, you gave up your rights for your own will. Now, we still have a free will, but really, Jesus bought you by his blood, and you are his. You're his bride. You're his. Now, that's weird for us husbands, right? Us men don't go, oh, I'm a bride. You know, we don't get it, right? But you are his. He's your love, and he's your husband, and you need to submit to him, and you need to love him. We need to realize that. Like a husband loves his wife and a wife loves her husband, given to them exclusively. The Hebrew concept of sanctification is seen in the instruments used in the temple. They were only to be used exclusively for the offerings and sacrifices of the temple. Hear this. Do you remember we just studied Daniel? What happened when Belshazzar, remember Babylonian king? He said, hey, he was partying, and he says, hey, let's go get the temple. Remember we got the goods from the temple? We got the goblets and stuff? Let's drink out of them. And he says, they say, it sounds like a good idea. Let's get it. And so they start drinking out of the goblets. And then it says all of a sudden when they're drinking, they see this hand, just a hand. I don't know if you was it the Munsters? Who had the hand? Do you remember? But it was just this hand. I mean, this hand starts right in the wall. And it says, meanie, meanie, miney, mo. No, okay. It says, meanie, meanie, tekel, upharsin, which means you've been weighed in the balance, and you've been left wanting. And it says Belshazzar, this big, powerful king, all of a sudden his knees started knocking together. How many? That's pretty bad when your knees are knocking together. And it says his bowels emptied. That means depends would have been a good thing for him. It's not good. You know, you heard this commercial. It's not good to fool Mother Nature. It's not good to mess with God and his sanctified things. God gets a little offended. He was allowing them to steal it. You can take it, but when you use my sanctified things for something immoral to party, then I have a problem. And he died that night. How many do not want your life or your family or this country to die? Then we who are sanctified need to start living set apart lives, not self-righteous lives. We're to be in this world, but hear this, not of it. We're to be engaged in this world, but we're to not live like the world. We're to show them a different lifestyle. Amen? Amen? Thus, the word, the very get-go, Paul comes with this powerful word to the Corinthians, and he says this, I know what your reputation was, being a Corinthian, being this drunkard, being this immoral person, but now you're a Christian, and now you're to be different. How many know we need to hear that today as the Church of America? I heard this pastor just told me Friday night, and I just wanted to lay hands on him. But he says, you know, Craig, he goes, the problem with the church today is we just need more grace. Grace, grace, grace. You know, just all this law and all this obedience stuff. We just need grace. You know, I mean, trust me, I love grace. But do you hear what he's trying to say? You know what I hear him saying? It says we just got to let people do what they want to do. But we wonder why our church, the Church of America, has such little effect. Because there isn't a distinction. There isn't a set apartness. There isn't a difference. And people go, I guess I'm a Christian. You know, 80% of Americans say they're Christian. Do you believe that? Have you driven down the road of Tucson and seen the love you get? I mean, seriously? If that's Christian, wow, I want a refund, right? I mean, it's crazy. But how many know we need to be set apart? We need to be different. And Paul's saying, you're to be different, Corinth. You're not to be like the city. You're to change the city and to be like Christ. You're to be set apart for God and his purposes exclusively. Remember this? Remember when Moses stood before the burning bush? What did God say? He said, take off your shoes, for this is holy ground. And he goes, okay. But why was it holy? Was there something special about the bush? The specialness of the bush was not just it was a bush being burned but not consumed, but it was because God was there. But how many know God lives in you now? You're a temple of God. You are a little ark. You know? You remember Raiders of the Lost Ark and the eyes burning? You are that ark. You are a carrier and courier of God's presence. And you don't believe that? Paul says, if you join with a prostitute, you join Christ with her. That's how one God sees you. Remember when persecuting, remember what Jesus said to Paul on the road to Emmaus? He said, Paul, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? He sees himself as one with his people. And guess what? You and I are to be holy. And when we, like Belshazzar, when we mix our bodies with unholy things, it grieves God. It hurts God. It diminishes your witness, and it diminishes the name of Jesus. I love that song that says, I want to spread your fame. I want to bring glory back to, I believe God wants to bring glory back to his church. Honor back to his church. To where it's not like, oh yeah, Christian. But it's like, wow, you're a Christian. Wow, okay. Wouldn't that be cool? The Christian means something noble again, something honorable again. 1 Corinthians 6:9, to show the opposite of being set apart. Hear this. 1 Corinthians 6:9, here's what he says. Because some people will say, oh, you know, hey, you know, whatever, I don't care. Hear this, let me start this off. Kevin, I think, did I get this right? You said that the dating, the online Christian dating, is that 40% of people on online Christian dating believe that fornication is all right as long as you love the person or commit for, what? Higher? What is it? What? Over 50. Half of all Christians on online dating believe you can have sex before marriage, fornicate, as long as you're committed to the person you like them. Over half. Ding, 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 ding. Here's what Paul says about that. 1 Corinthians 6:9. Don't you realize that those who do wrong, he's talking to Christians now, who do wrong will not inherit the kingdom of God? That should scare a lot of those 50% of those Christians, should it not? Don't fool yourselves. Those who indulge in sexual sin or who worship idols or commit adultery. And people say, oh, you just pick on homosexuality. Adultery, fornication's in here. Or male prostitutes, or practice homosexuality, or thieves, we never think of that, thieves, or greedy people, or drunkards, or those who are abusive, or cheat people, none of these will inherit the kingdom of God. Wow. How many others should be some people in the church today going, their knees should be like that? And hear this, guys. It's not saying if you've committed adultery, you can't be saved. It's not saying if you have fornicated, you can't be saved. It's not saying if you've been a homosexual, you can't be saved. It's saying, are you a homosexual now? There's a difference between being an adulterer and someone who's committed adultery. Do you understand? There's a difference. Are you given to it, or have you done it and repented? Amen? But if you're continually in it, right? Because people, what are people saying now? And hear this. This is why I pick on homosexuality. This is what I want to tell you. Because I have yet to say someone come up to me and go, you know, Pastor Craig, my son, he is a fornicating fool. You just keep your daughter away because he is just a fornicator for Jesus. I've never had anyone say that. Amen? Now, I've said my kid struggles with it, but I've never had anyone be proud of it. Hey, that's what my son is. He's got the fornicating gene. I've never had anyone come up to me and say, oh my goodness, my husband, he is an adulterer. He's got the adulterer gene. He is an adulterer for Jesus. But I've heard people say to me, I'm a Christian, my son is a Christian homosexual. Not was, is. Now hear this. Here's the hope here. Listen to verse 11. This circle, if you're in your Bible, write this verse right here. Circle it. He says, Paul says, some or such were some of you. Don't you like that? Were. We need to get the were back into the church. Not still are for 20 years, still keep being a fornicator, still keep being an adulterer, still keep being a homosexual or drunkard. Such were some of you. So that's good. I mean, that gets good because it means the church is full of sinners. But here's the problem I have. Too many people are still in that and say, that's who I am. And they'll say, you've seen the bumper sticker? Christians aren't perfect, just forgiven. Paul's not saying that here. God through Paul is not saying that. Here's what he says. Such were some of you were once like that, but hear this, you were cleansed. I like that, don't you? By the blood of Jesus. You were made holy, set apart. You were made right with God by calling on the name of Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of God. Don't you love that? You want to hear how you do this? When I got saved, I was a sinner, big time sinner. I mean, I'm still a sinner, but I was big time into sin. And you don't need to know, I mean, some of you know, I've told you, but I struggle with everything. Drunk, well, not homosexuality, but drunkenness. I struggle with that, womanizing, with partying, drugs. But what happened was, I said, I remember reading one of the first verses I learned was Galatians 5:16. And it says, walk by the Spirit so you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. How many like that? So we need to pray, Lord, teach me. Write that verse down. Teach me how to walk by the Spirit. Because guess what? Be strong in the Lord, it says in Ephesians 6:10. Be strong in the Lord in the strength of His mighty power. He is the one who gives you the strength to say no to sin, to overcome sin. Amen? It's not your willpower. It's God. The opposite word for sanctified is defiled. The word defiled means to make foul, to be impure, to make filthy or dirty, to pollute. Let me give you a little example of this. I want to give you a little analogy because I can see some of you are kind of getting a little sleepy on me. But hear this. This is good water. Good water. So here it is. There's a bunch of water. How many know that's sanctified water? That's drinking water. That's not from the toilet. Good water. So there it is. There's some water. And how many would be excited to drink that water? You'd drink that water, right? Bottled water. Some of you, my wife says, oh, it's plastic. Can't drink plastic stuff. But now, so there it is. That's what happens to you when you become a Christian. You had dirty water, but now it's clean. Your water's clean. You are sanctified, set apart. This is just for drinking, right? This isn't going to, you know, not going to do anything else. But now, look at this. If I take this good water, and I take this little friend of mine, a little sewer roach. Yeah, I wake you up. There you go. Oh, sick. I was thinking about my roast beef sandwich. Oh, my goodness. And I put this in the water. How many know that water? Does anyone drink it besides my son, Cannon? Who would drink this? That water is defiled, okay? That water, now hear this. Some of you girls go, you see, this is why people leave this church. This is why. See that? It's a plastic roach. It's not real, okay? Mariah wanted me to use dog poo. And I said, I think that's a little, even for me, whoa, dog poo. And Kevin goes, I don't want that on the stage. No way. So this is a plastic roach. Fake, not real. I wasn't touching. Somebody go, I'm not shaking his hand. No way. Right? Plastic roach. But how many know if that was a real roach, none of you would be excited to drink this water. And just like you're not excited to drink this water, how many know God's not excited to have people who have sewer roaches running through them of sin? And we need to say, God, help get those sewer roaches out. If you have sewer roaches in your house, right? I used to, when I first gave her, I had an apartment, and we used to keep it so hot to save money that the sewer roaches would literally fly in our apartment. I guess if it gets hot enough, and then they would leave these trails of like black stuff all over the walls. Boy, oh boy. You know, I wanted them out, okay? I think we put like Drano down the side. I mean, we did everything. But hear this, that's defiled, amen? None of us want to be like that, hopefully, right? Amen? Okay, good. I should have told you it was real, you'd be more locked in. But anyway, the Corinthian Christians were not to let ourselves be defiled or polluted by this world, but instead we're to be set apart, to be holy. That's what the word holy means also. It means to be set apart for only God and His work for us. Not for this world and not for all its defiling sewer roaches that try to pollute us, but we're to be set apart for Him. And of verse 2, and I'm almost done. Called to be saints with all who are in every place, call on the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, both theirs and ours. The words again, to be here, is in italics. Therefore, more correct rendering of this phrase, delete the words to be again, and because hear this, you don't work to be a saint. Amen? You either are or you're not. That's why the title of this message is sinner or saint. You're either in Christ and you're a saint or you're not a saint. It's not an honor given to a holy few like Mother Teresa just got initiated into sainthood. How many know this? We're all saints if we're in Christ. Not every one of us, every one of us who is truly born again is a saint. You could call me Saint Gregory, right? Sounds good, doesn't it? Saint Gregory, right? And you're a saint. All of us who are in Christ are a saint. Amen? You don't earn it. You don't do a couple miracles and then you're a saint. Like Mother Teresa, you are a saint or you're a sinner. You're either not in Christ, a sinner, or you're someone who was a sinner. Doesn't mean we don't sin, but we are now declared by God a saint. Amen? So you're a saint. So call yourself, you know, saint, whatever. 2 Timothy 2:20 says this, "But in a great house, there are not only vessels of gold and silver, but also wood and clay, some for honor and some for dishonor." So do you hear that? In a house, there's gold and silver vessels. How many know you put good things in that? But the clay and wood, what would you put in it? Some of it could be a bedpan, because a lot of times they had outhouses, they didn't want to have it, so they could use it as a bedpan. But they would also use it for, how many know, there wasn't garbage disposal, so they'd put slop in like a wooden bowl. How many do not want to be the slop bowl? Okay, so he says there's two kinds of vessels. There's vessels of honor and dishonor. Verse 21, "Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself..." So there's a free will. So God declares you a saint, but you now need to cleanse yourself. You need to walk it out. "Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from the latter, from being a vessel of dishonor, being that vessel of slop bucket, he will be a vessel of honor, sanctified, set apart, useful for the master and prepared for every good work." How many want to be that? Do you see that? Besides doing it, you should do it because you love Jesus. Jesus said what? If you love me, you will what? Obey my commandments. But besides that, if you need a little motivation for you personally, do it for this, that you can be that vessel of honor, that God, you are useful to God, and you are fit for every good work. You're prepared for every good work. Because guess what? Your sewer roaches in your life, they clog the flow of God. I want to have a life where God can come in and flow in me and through me. Amen? Because I will tell you this, if you're not sure how true this is, how many know? If you did a big sin last night and you say, and someone says, "Hey, pray for me, I'm feeling sick, pray for me." How many know the first thing you're going to hear in your head is, "Hey, how can you pray for me? You just did that sin. You aren't worthy. Oh. How many want to get, I want to get tired of giving the devil place in my life. It's hard to pray the prayer of faith when you're struggling with shame because you're walking in willful sin. Amen. So let's choose to say, "God, help me to walk by the Spirit so I can be that vessel of honor, vessel that's fit for every good work." Now, some of you might be saying, if you're smart enough, you're still awake. Some of you might be saying, "But Craig, didn't you just say that being a saint is not something you work at being? Because you just said cleanse yourself, so that's a work, is it not?" Some reason I didn't even hear you, but whatever. But he's right. But it's a work, right? You just said cleanse yourself, so that sounds like work. But hear this. The proof that I'm truly a saint is that I'll be becoming a vessel of honor. That I'll become more of a vessel of honor today than I was yesterday. Amen? And hear this. Isaiah 61:10 says we've been robed in his righteousness. That means when we accepted Christ, he robed us in his righteousness. How many like that? Romans says justified, just as if you never sinned. When God looks at you, he sees you totally forgiven because you've been washed by the blood of Jesus. But hear this. That's the start of salvation. That's the start of Christianity. But now hear this. The Bible always has paradoxes. We like to lock in one truth and say, "Okay, I'm cleansed, so now I can do whatever I want." No, you're cleansed, and now here's the second half. Romans 13:14. He says, "Now put on Christ and give no opportunity for the flesh." So guess what? We're to clothe ourselves with righteousness. We're to put on the righteousness. We've been declared righteous. Now we're to actualize righteousness. Does that make sense? We're to now walk it out. We're not just saying, "Hey, Christians aren't perfect, just forgive me, I'm cleansed, I can do whatever." No, now you say, "I want to walk like Jesus. I want to be a vessel of honor, fit for every good work." And that takes some discipline and some work, does it not? It does. Anyone says, "Oh, no, it's easy to be a Christian." No, it's not. So hear this. Here's the balance. Martin Luther, how many love the great reformer Martin Luther? Two of you, okay, good. But anyways, he said this. He said, "Faith in Christ plus nothing." He was fighting works. And he says, "Faith in Christ plus nothing." How many believe that, right? Faith in Christ, that's how you get saved. Faith in Christ. You don't work to be saved, you just have faith in Christ. But hear this, and Martin Luther was so locked into grace, faith you know, justification by faith, that he hated, he said, the book of James. He later recanted, I'm told, that he took it back. But hear this, he said it was a book of straw. But here's what James says to balance him out. He says, but some of you say, like Martin Luther, I'm adding that, you have faith and I have works. Show me, James says, your faith without works, and I will show you my faith by my works. Hear this, guys. Faith, works do not save you. Amen? But the proof that you have true faith in Christ will have good works. Amen? You don't work to be saved. You work because you are saved and because you're so appreciative of what God's done for you. Because what is grace? Unmerited, undeserved. You're like, thank you, Lord. And Paul says it so well in 1 Corinthians 15:10. He says, I am what I am by the grace of God. And because of the grace of God, I work harder than all the other apostles. But he kind of catches himself, but not I, but the grace of God within me. True grace will work. See, we've been taught cheap grace. We've been taught sloppy agape grace. Hey, just receive Jesus and do whatever you want. No. You've been clothed, you've been cleansed. Now you've been freed in grace to walk in a right, righteous life, right standing with God. I want to end with this. Thanks for being patient with me. Hebrews 12:14 says this, middle of the verse. Work, it's a New Living Translation, it says, work at living a holy life. So it says work. Work at living a holy life, for those who are not holy will not see the Lord. Did you hear what that just said? Work at living a holy life, for those who are not holy will not see the Lord. Does anyone here want to see the Lord? Then we need to be holy. We need to say, Lord, thank you that you've positionally made me righteous, but now help me to walk out that righteousness, to live that life of vessel. No more sewer roaches. Amen? I'm going to ask, how are your roaches? Right? No roaches for Jesus, right? We're not legalized marijuana guys, right? No, okay. But that was a little joke. But anyways, let's pray. Is that all right? You learn anything? You guys are real mellow today. I don't know what it is. I don't know. What? Is the roaches got you high? All right, okay. Well, let's pray and ask God to just do this work in us. Father, thank you so much for your word. And Lord, I just thank you for this church and for their heart for your word. And I pray, Lord, that we would be a people who thank you that you've declared us saints, that you've declared us holy and sanctified. But now, Lord, I pray for that balance, Lord. We don't want to be a works-based church, but we also don't want to be a like the Corinthians, just grace, 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 and a man can sleep with his father's wife and just craziness. We want to be holy as you are holy. And not to be self-righteous or bragging, but we want to be, as it says in 2 Timothy 2:20, we want to be those vessels of honor that are fit for, prepared for every good work, that we can be used by you, that we, our lives, our families, our marriages, our children will have great effect in our community. And so, Lord, I ask that you would sanctify us, not just positionally, but you would fill us with your Holy Spirit. And you from the inside out would work in us to say, you know what, I want to be holy. I don't want to be that vessel full of roaches. I don't want to be the vessel full of slop. I want to be a vessel of honor that gives glory to you, Father, that's prepared for you to use and work through. So, Lord, change our hearts. Let us not be one extreme or the other. Let us not go from grace to works. And let us not go from works to grace. But let us have that balance of grace and works, like James says, I will show you my faith in Christ plus nothing by my good works. So let us be a people who can take these truths of God and marry them together and balance them to where we are a people that believe we're justification by faith, not by works. But yet, because we're truly saved, we will produce good fruit. I love how you said it, Jesus. You said a good tree cannot produce bad fruit. It means it won't consistently do sin. But a good tree will produce good fruit. And you said you'll know them, not by their profession of faith, but you'll know them by their fruit. And I pray that every one of us here would be secure in our faith.
Because every one of us could say, not that I prayed a prayer, but every one of us can say, God is changing my life. My life is more sanctified and set apart for Him today than it was yesterday or a week ago. Bless your church. Bless all who hear this message. Let us be holy that we might be a witness to a lost and dying world that's cynical and disillusioned, that wants truth. Let us be those vessels of your truth that scream the reality of your power to redeem a life, to take a life from the dunghill and place it on a rock, to take it from the miry pit and place it on the rock of your Son, to redeem it, to change it, to save it. Let this church be a church of grace, true grace that works, true grace that works. Bless your people, for it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.